Good evening, everybody. How are you tonight? In my life, I've been inspired by those who have fought this terrible disease called cancer. I've been inspired by our survivors, and I'm proud to say that my father is one of those survivors. I'll never forget when my father was first diagnosed with prostate cancer. Dad started acting differently, and he started talking to me differently, and I guess when you go through something like this in your life, it affects you. And I want to say thank you tonight to all those family members, all those caregivers, because I know that you're right there in the struggle as we battle for the cure of this disease. But I'll never forget my father once telling me, he said, Chris, he goes, you know where the wealthiest place in the world actually is? I said, Dad, I don't know. And he said, the wealthiest place in the world is the graveyard. I said, Dad, what are you talking about? Why are you saying that? And he said, Chris, he goes, none of us are guaranteed tomorrow. Time is precious. Life is short. There's work to be done. And in the graveyard, there's all of these dreams. There's all of these aspirations. There's all of these hopes that were never reached for. There's all of these inventions that we were never exposed to because someone didn't take a risk. He said it shouldn't take a disease like cancer for people to understand that. And he said, I wish we all got when we were young that we are all terminal, we are all dying. Some of us are just lucky enough to know it. And the most powerful thing on this earth, the most powerful currency in this world, is our ability to affect others' lives in a positive manner. There has not been one survivor, one person that has fought cancer that I have been around that does not know those lessons. So my challenge to you tonight is your ability to understand how precious time is, how we must take advantage of every moment, live life to the fullest, take risks, dream big dreams. We need to learn from you. Our society needs to learn from you. We look up to you, we pray for you, we support you, and we love you. So keep up the battle. You are truly heroes. And so tonight, I have the honor of introducing a hero here in Clinton County in the city of Frankfort. I'll always remember Mrs. Binge when I was younger in school. And Linda always had a smile on her face, no matter what. She always greeted you with a hug. She was always positive. She was always optimistic. And she not only was a fantastic professional, but she was a fantastic mother. And she was someone who always showed love. I can't wait to hear her words tonight. Help me give a big round of applause to a survivor, a hero, Mrs. Linda Binge.
Well, hello. I am a survivor. Say that if you are. I am a survivor. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Chris. Little Chris McBarnes, I was his teacher a long time ago. I was introduced to cancer way back in the 1900s, 1969 to be exact, when my 8-year-old cousin passed with childhood leukemia. And tonight, I met a little girl who's, I think, 7. Mercedes, where are you, honey? Her niece, who, there's a little girl back there with childhood leukemia who is a survivor. So what we're doing here tonight is important because it is raising money for research so we can identify some of these cancers and attack them and kill them dead. cancer from all sorts of places. My grandpa died of cancer, my uncle, another aunt, another uncle, all along life. And I knew about cancer, but it was kind of on the periphery of my life. Until 2008, when I accompanied my mother to the Veterans Hospital in Indianapolis, where they told us that my dad had terminal melanoma, and they were giving him 6 to 8 months to live. And I thought in my head, well, you don't know my God. And I immediately got all of my prayer warriors to start praying for him. So for the next year, he came to know the Lord. He prayed with us and was pretty much ready to go whenever God was calling him to go. It was a good 14 months before he did leave us. But in the summer of 2009, I had neglected to get a mammogram for 4 years. I got the card from my doctor that said, you need to come in. The last mammogram I had, they said I was kind of lumpy and full of cysts. So I didn't really think too much about it, so I neglected it. 4 years later, in 2009, I was doing a self-breast exam, so keep doing those, ladies, and found a lump, and went to the doctor, and it's kind of ironic because I was in the gym right next door to us when I got a phone call that told me, yes, you do have cancer. It's breast cancer. We need to get you an oncologist, a radiologist, a chemotherapist. Do you have a surgeon? All of those words that we don't ever really want to hear. And all of a sudden now, they're going to be mine. My oncologist, my radiologist, my chemotherapist, my surgeon. And I was working with one of the students here at Franklin High School, and I remember getting a phone call and slumping up against the wall, thinking, oh Lord, I have cancer. I could die. And yet here comes this kid that I'm working with out. I was helping with a PE class, and we had to go out and learn how to play tennis. And we went out and learned how to play tennis. And in my head, I'm thinking, I have cancer. I could die. Hey, get that ball. It was so strange, just very surreal. And another memory that I have implanted on my brain is sitting on my front porch with my husband, and I'm sitting in the swing, and he's sitting in the chair, and I'm sitting thinking, I could die from this. Crying, thinking, oh dear. And I look over at him, and he's sitting there, staring off, tears are in his eyes, and it just struck me, Linda, you are not the only victim here. Your husband might lose his wife. Your children might lose their mother. My parents might lose a daughter. Quit sitting here feeling sorry for yourself. Fight this thing. So I went over to my husband immediately and hugged him, and I said, we're going to just be strong through this. And so we started. And as many of you all already know this, you go to the doctors, you go to the radiologist, you get your schedule of things that you have to do to fight this. And my school was extremely supportive. They started bringing food over. They started giving me gas cards for trips back and forth to Indianapolis. I love my hair. I'm very vain about my hair. My school teachers told me that they would let me cut off my send it to make a human hair wig. I said, no, I'm not that big. We're not going to do that. Look what God did. Those of you that know me know just pretty much how my hair is and was. So thank you, Lord. So in September of 2009, I remember going over and telling my parents, called all of my children, and I remember sitting on that porch and feeling devastated, and then getting the resolve to fight this thing. What I'm going to say to you next is not about cancer. Well, it kind of is about cancer, but it's about life that goes on, because you have to. You can't just lay down and die. In September is when I found out that I had cancer, feeling devastated, but resolving to fight. In October of 2009, my husband and I got a phone call that said that our 25-year-old daughter did not wake up that day. And she had some medical problems, but nothing fatal. Yet, here we were thrown into the busyness of escorting her out of this world. And I remember thinking, I would take cancer 1,000 times to not have to do this thing. So any of you that are out there that have cancer, yes, we're all gonna die. We're not gonna leave this world unless there's a rapture coming without dying. But we're all alive today. Are you alive today? Some of us lose the battle. Now, one of these days, I'm probably going to lose the battle, but today, I'm okay. The following month of 2009 is when my father passed. And he had, like I said, come to accept the Lord. I knew where he was going, I knew where my daughter was, and I know how to get there. What I would like to leave you with this evening is I look around and I see my family, I see a lot of my friends, longtime friends, new friends, I see relatives, I see strangers, but we're all in this together. It takes a community to get through cancer. So I am so thankful for every single person, man, woman, and child that's in this room, that's in this community, that is helping to find a cure for cancer. Keep up the fight. Don't be discouraged, because look around you. You're not alone, and you're not going to be alone. Hang on to your faith, hang on to your family, and love the people that God puts around you. My daughter's motto was, love God, love people. Simple. Live each day. Like Chris said, we don't have any promises of tomorrow. We certainly can't go back and change anything from yesterday. We have right now. So right now, we are celebrating another birthday for each one of us who are a survivor in this room. Is it time for the survivor lap or the balloon release?
Call the survivors out here for the spot.
So survivors, come on. God bless you all.
All right, so we're going to ask our survivors. please come up here to the front. If you've been diagnosed from 1 to 2 years, line up behind them. 2 to 5 years. I know we have a 5-year survivor out there. Yeah, that's right. And then 5 to 7, if you're between 5 to 7 years survivorship, line up behind them.
No, really.
Between 7 and 10.
Oh, God.
10 to 15. And then 15 years plus. Is there anybody out there with 20 years of survivorship? We have one gentleman out there with 20 years of survivorship. Congratulations and happy birthday. I want those of you that are up front to turn around and look behind you. Because what stands behind you is hope. The individuals standing behind you have fought cancer, and they're still here, and there is hope. And that's what all of us are here for this evening. So, are we ready to get this party started?
Looking good. There you go, Rox. Looking good, guys. Looking good. got no hook. I did my best for it.
He's running for Mr. Relay for 911 cancer survivors. On and fighting now. Why should people support him instead of the other contestants for I am anti-O cancer for the fight against the horrible disease? Described his outfit is purple skirt. The third contestant, team name is For a Cure. Contestant's stage name is Jam. Real name is Will. Why are you running for Mr. Relay in support of my very recently deceased grandmother Jam, who died of bone cancer, and my girlfriend, who is a cancer survivor? Why should you support me instead of the other contestants? Because I've got dope swag. Describe the outfit loving sleeveless blue blouse, black leggings, and flip-flops. My pails, totes, matching the outfit. And our last but not least contestant, team name is St. Vincent's Frankfort Hospital. Stage name is Hallie. Real name is Lance. Why are you running for Mr. Relay? I want to help out. Why should people support you? So please support all those people when they come around to get money. All right, this is contestant number one. Contestant number two is Ward's Warriors. Contestant number three is Bowen Strong, Derby Car. Contestant number four is Frito-Lay, Mahler Ice Cream Truck. Contestant number five is the Farmer's Bank. Contestant number six is St. Vincent's Frankfort Hospital. Number seven, Farming for More Birthdays. And the final contestant, number eight, Hearts Bleed Blue, We Bleed for a Cure.
Thank you. About those we honor with these luminaria who have passed, I say, you whose memory we honor today, this light represents the love we have shared. It burns for others to see, but it burns brightest in our hearts and in our souls. You were and always will be a part of us. Though we do not see you, you know you are with us. For those we honor today who are currently fighting a battle, or who have won, we light these candles as your continued commitment to the fight. You have survived it, and we will help you fight it until a cure is found. These lights glow in honor of you. And now we'll have the reading of the names by Mary McBarnes.
In honor of Kristen Arnone, Karen Barr, Lisa Beard, Carrie Beeler, Linda Binge, Wanda Wilson Burge, John Bowen, Mary LaVerne Bramble, Rick Brown, Lynn Bundy, Teresa Berger, Claudia Coomer, Kathy Crow, John Crum, Jackie Davidson, Alice Davis, Billy Davis, Jim Davison, Richard Davison, Dean and Elaine, Maxie Duffy, Patrick Duffy, Bev Epley, Dawn Fearnow, Debbie Freeman, Steve Freeman, Lana Freestone, Dave Friend, Carol Gay, Mary Kay George, Kathy Hall, Judy Haynes, Amy Height, Samuel Holliger, Victoria Hopkins, Spicy Huck, Ganlyn Huckleberry, Norm Hover, Hank Jarrett, David Johnston, Dennis Kinsler, Mitzi Helms Lanier, Lana, Harley Lawrence, Tracy Lawrence, Cheyenne Lewis, Heather M. Bell Majors, Heather Matthews, Sherry Mossbeck, Steve Oslo, Janet Hillian, Barbara Plake, Deb Pollard, Melanie Ratcliffe, Rosie Rash, Ruby Sacra, Sonia Sacra, Nancy Sanders, Melissa Smith, Lori Staley, Joanne Stanley, Bernice Stroop, Daryl Tay, Jack Taylor, Shirley Taylor, Judy Vierostedt, Jean Wade, Donna Wallace, Cindy Walters, Jackie Ward, Scott E. Werner, April Williams, Loretta Wynn, Linda Woodward, Caitlin Wright, Crystal Wright, Margie Wyrick, Pam Young, Nikki. In memory of
Dolly Abstin, Bruce Atkins, Cherry Archer, Aunt Susie, Judy Avery, Jim Ayers, Jerry Bachman, Joanne Bachman, Rosemary Barnett, Stacy Ball, Arthur Beard, Peggy Beard, Barney Belt, Carol Boland, Leo and Maxine Bond, Jerry Bramble, Ferris Bray, Gary Bray, Ralph Butler, Wilmley Butts, Tom Carter, Bonnie Chester, Tom Chow, Carol Coleman, Barbara Cook, Wayne Cordwell, Edwin Cox, Eva Peach Cox, Lois Cox, Don L. Crum, Jerry Daniels, Esther Davis, Jack Davis, G. Dissinger, Helen Dushby, Andy Ehrman, Scott Elsie, Randall K. Ferguson, Dan Federick, Wayne Foster, Phyllis Garrison, James Gibson, Susan Giles, Robert and Geneva Goodnight, Sue Griffith, Rhonda Hall, Gladys Haynes, Patricia Hodgen, Trisha Hodgen, Ike Hollingsworth, Carol Hood, Sophie Hood, Stephanie Hood, Joseph Eisenberg Sr., Walter Johnston, Ruth Kidwell, Katie and Rick Kinslow, Sherry Kaiser, Stan Prisico, Tom Livingston, Carol Laux, Marilyn Laux, Rick Martin, Linda K. B., Florence Michael, Martha Miller, Jane Miller, Patricia Miller, Sid Moore, Tim Morgan, Terry Myers, Bertha Nolly, Bob Nolly, Warner Nolly, Betty Overton, Tom Piercy, Lenny Pittman, Marcella Primer, Virginia D. Rich, William H. Rich Sr., Mary Kinslow Ross, Shirley Ross, Larry Lynn Roush, Archie Sanders, Jeanette Seifert, Carrie Seifert, Donald Scott, the entire Shockey family, Kathleen Sheets, Kathy Skinner, Bonnie Smith, Karen Stevens, Ray Stokes, Baby Dean Sturville, Rebecca Tay, Helen Taylor, Orville Taylor, Joella Tillis, Ann Timmons, Charles Timmons, Tom Tolan, Charles Tony, Stephen Torrance, Sonny Vale, Frank Way, Rosemary McBee Wallace, Patty Wan, Vivian Ward, Judy Warren, Mary Elizabeth Warren, Bonnie and Dale Welton, A. Werner, Virginia West, Elaine and Ralph White, Phyllis Ogle Williams, Lloyd L. Wilson, friends and family of the Wilson family, Robert Woods, Keith Zook, and all who have lost their battle.
Right now, I'd ask that you guys go ahead and take your silent lap. You can start that. And we'll walk in silence in memory of those that we have lost.
participated in the luminary ceremony. You can take your cups if you would like, otherwise leave them. We'll be going and walking laps and dancing and celebrating life as it is today.